Hey everyone, Coach Lance from OnlineHockeyTraining.com. Thanks for stopping by and welcome to another shot of the old Sunday motivational video, which also happens to be one that I've been super excited about making for a few weeks now. Each Sunday, I want to bring you something that once you've finished watching, you'll feel that the minutes you've just used up from your 24 hours consuming this video were viewed as productive and positive. Today we're going to be talking about adversity, why some people struggle during these times and others thrive. You might be asking the question, how can this be a motivational video if I'm going to be talking about adversity?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
I know it's hard to comprehend right now, but I promise you, this will all make sense by the end of the video. If you're new here, make sure you subscribe and turn on that notifications button or you'll be missing out. Dictionary.com defines adversity as an adverse or unfavorable fortune or fate, a condition marked by misfortune, calamity, or distress. An example of this would be going through a tornado. In a matter of minutes, your life gets turned upside down and you now have a new normal for a while. Have you ever had a time in your life when you had to go through something that was really difficult, seemed to last forever, and was completely out of your control? Of course you have. It's a guaranteed part of this game of life. There's bad stuff and good stuff. The really smart people in this world have labeled these life experiences as going through adversity. These difficult times we face in our lives come wrapped in all kinds of different appearances. These speed bumps or walls that pop up out of nowhere don't care about how old you are, what color your skin is, or if you're male or female. These challenging times have one objective and one objective only, and that's to try to puck up your life as much as possible. But what happens when a child is born into a challenge right out of the gate? This is the story of Callan, the magic man. About a month ago, I was contacted by a mom inquiring about getting her 7-year-old son in for an off-ice stick handling and shooting lesson, which is exactly what I specialize in, but little did I know that that phone call would change my life forever. It was a typical call where the parent will tell me a little bit about their player. I asked one question at some point during this initial call, and that's, does your son or daughter love hockey? And if the answer is yes, then we have a match and I book the lesson. If you had a chance to see Callan in action, there's nothing that jumps out at you from an adversity perspective. He appears to be super active and willing to try anything. I see nothing but normal here. But as Callan's mom peeled back a few more layers of the onion, she informed me that he was born with something called symbracodactyly, which is a congenital condition where, in many cases, bones will be missing from fingers and some fingers or toes may be missing altogether. In Callan's case, he was missing 3 fingers in one of his hands, but has a very functional pinky finger and thumb. As I told his parents, I have no idea how this is going to go, but as long as he has a strong passion for the sport, I'd absolutely 100% see if I could help. Our first initial meeting was on October 24th and was one I was really looking forward to since I booked the lesson. Callan, his sister, and parents arrived, and as you can see, he was pretty fired up for the lesson. In any first lesson I have with a player, I typically make 2 to 5 corrections, which addresses where a player's hands are positioned on the stick and body, the function of each hand when dribbling or shooting, and where the ball or puck is positioned on the stick when handling it. I can get all the information I need from having a player do a couple drills. Callan came to me as a right-hander, where his affected hand, or what has become known as the magic hand, is his top hand. In observing him do a couple stick handling drills, as expected, his bottom hand would be the dominant one, and it was, which is completely opposite of what should be happening with each hand. You see, stick handling, or more specifically dribbling, is what we do most when we possess the puck. The controlling hand, or what I call the engine, should be the top hand and should be doing all the work. But as you can see here, his bottom hand is doing most of the work. Every engine needs fuel to operate, and the fuel for our top hand engine is what's called the top hand wrist roll. This movement allows the stick blade to cup over the top when handling a ball or puck and should be powered mostly by the top hand. The bottom hand should have a loose grip with very little movement. So this was the first red flag that popped up. Once I got all the information I needed from a stick handling perspective, we then moved on to doing some in-tight shooting. You may not know it, but when taking a shot, your bottom hand pushes forward and at the exact same time your top hand pulls back. This is important to know. This is the only clip that showed what I was seeing. Almost every time he took a shot, his top hand would lose its grip and would release from the knob of the stick. This was the second red flag that popped up. I now had all the information I needed from the lesson, and once they left, Callan was all that I could think about. You see, in any first lesson, I have to know what fuels the player. What are they chasing? What race are they in? I know he seems so young, but this kid has a lofty objective, and that's to one day play college hockey. So I started there and worked my way backwards, and very quickly came to the conclusion that that objective of playing college hockey wouldn't be attainable if he stayed on the same course. And here's why. Right now, Callan doesn't have the strength in his top hand yet, and he's years away from getting it, not months. I believe that if he stays on his current path of being a right-hander, that he's going to be left behind because he won't be able to acquire the stick skills at the same pace as his peers, resulting in him quitting hockey within 2 to 3 years. I felt so strongly about this, my suggestion to Callan's parents was that we convert him over to being a left-handed hockey player. Apparently, I wasn't the only one who had this same strategy, as it was suggested prior, but Callan wanted no part of that operation, so I had to find a way or ways to get him to buy into the concept and really get excited about it. I first needed to give them something that supported this radical action. I started with a puck possession study conducted by USA Hockey back in 2002 during the Salt Lake City Olympic Winter Games. Members of the USA Hockey's coaching education program paired up and observed and recorded the action of the best players in the world, competing in 31 men's and 24 women's games. Basically, what they did was identify who was thought to be the top performers for every game, and they'd watch every shift and record how long they had the puck in their stick. The results were crazy, showing that on average, players only possessed the puck for right around 60 seconds. That's it. The second idea that popped into my head, in order to get him to buy into this major shift, was to see if I could improve the Magic Hands glove. All Callan has known is bulk and clunkiness. In an attempt to help hold his stick in the top hand, his parents constructed a mitten with magnets sewn into it and also had attached some magnets to the knob of his stick. Those weren't needed anymore, so I found an old glove of one of my boys, cut the padding out of the fingers, left the leather, brought it over to a longtime friend who sewed it up for me, and voila, the new Magic Hand glove.
Thanks so much, Christine.
Our second lesson was the following week, and I couldn't wait. Callan and his dad arrived, and we began the lesson by having a quick conversation. He now knows that I want to switch him over to a left-hander, and I made a picture showing what his end destination was, and he confirmed he still wants to play college hockey. I told him about USA Hockey's puck possession study and that it's only around 1 minute. I said, "You can figure out how to stick handle and shoot and pass for 1 minute, can't you, Cal?" He said, "Oh yeah, coach." This was a cool moment, one of many for the day. I asked Cal if he knew what day it was today. He said, "I don't know, coach." I then told him that it was my birthday, which it was, and that weird things happen here. Normally, the guy with the birthday usually gets the presents, but today, for some reason, you get the present. When a kid hears the word present, they lose their mind, and Callan was no different, but there was a catch. I informed him that if he was to open the present, he had to do one thing for me, and that was commit to being a left-handed hockey player from this moment on. There wasn't much hesitation as he said yes and started ripping it open. Needless to say, both Cal and his dad were pretty happy. I had enough of a wait and wanted to have him give it a try, as he said it felt so good compared to what he had been using up until this point. I couldn't have scripted what happened next better than when he took his first shot as a left-hander. His facial expression says it all. He was pretty jacked, and so was I. Right now, I know he'll be able to stick handle, pass, and shoot on the forehand, but the last test is what happens when he takes backhand shots. His grip kept on breaking, and the glove would fly off most shots. With that being said, the glove was a little big for him, but at least it was a starting point. As I told Callan's parents, I have no idea how this is going to go, as I'm doing it all on feel and what I'm seeing for the moment. Speaking of moments, here was the best one yet. Since the glove was a little too big, I wanted to see what would happen if he shot without the glove on, so we gave that a try. After only a few attempts, I'm 100% certain that Cal will be just fine. His grip didn't break on any of the shots, so right then and there, I knew he's in the game and I believe has the same chance as any other 7-year-old to go as far in hockey that hasn't been affected by this challenge. This is so cool. We ended up visiting again the following week and things were going well. Mom and Dad used the glove prototype I made for him and did the same thing to a pair that fit much better, which is awesome. But after speaking with Callan's parents, he still hadn't fully committed, as he was still trying to negotiate time being both a left-handed hockey player and the hockey player I didn't want to exist anymore, and that was the right-handed Callan. At the end of the lesson, Coach had to give him a little nudge, so I asked if I could keep his right-handed stick with me until we met again 2 weeks later. I said I needed it for making this video. Cal hasn't figured it out yet, but Coach always gets what he wants out of players. He reluctantly gave me a stick, and now, if he wanted to do anything with a hockey stick, it had to be with his new left-handed stick. The 2 weeks flew by for me, and I started to really get anxious the day before our fourth lesson together. I was so hopeful that things went well for him since our last meeting. In talking with his dad about how things had been going on the ice, the feedback he was getting from the coaches on ice was that he wasn't using his bottom hand as much as he should, trying to catch passes with only the top hand on the stick. That was a great bit of intel, as I had the practice plan in my brain for the day. Try to do as many engaging drills that only can be done while having both hands on the stick. The first drill we did has a great track record with the players I've worked with in the past. I'm behind the net and will one after another flip a puck over the net. Cal's objective is to try to catch it on his forehand. As you can see from this footage, the bottom hand stayed on the stick the whole time. Phase one, mission accomplished. Side note, this is Callan's sister Reese. You'll see her around once in a while. I call her the mint monster, as she eats up all my mints when she's here. She's so awesome. The next drill I did with Cal was shooting a puck standing up. The purpose of the drill was to get him to feel the puck on the stick blade with his bottom hand. Up until this point, all he's really done is slap at pucks, and he knows now there's no slappy slappy with this drill. I followed up with rolling a puck toward him. What I was targeting here was a continuation of feeling the puck on the forehand prior to releasing the shot and his footwork, where he was stepping to the net for each shot. This drill took on a life of its own with Callan, as it was one he didn't want to leave quite yet, as he had one objective, and that was to roof one top shelf for the first time as a left-hander. So I kept rolling pucks and he kept ripping away shot after shot. I had to force him to take breaks because he just kept on battling. Even when he was supposed to be resting, I'd catch him standing up pucks, getting in a few more reps. The determination in this kid is unreal. To give him a break from that chase, I told him I needed to see how he did the same drill, but now taking backhand shots. I had him not use his glove for this one again, and as you can see, there is no issue with backhand shots. And looky there, he's getting consistent elevation as well. Mission accomplished again. After a short break, he wanted to get back to forehand shots. So I rolled puck after puck, and he kept shooting, getting so close on so many attempts, but he just couldn't get one to go. The lesson time was about to expire, so I rolled him his last two pucks. Once again, he got so close on the last one, firing it off the crossbar. So getting his first top shelf as a left-hander would have to happen down the road. But wait, just because I had ended the lesson, it wasn't over yet for Cal, as he hadn't given up on the last puck. He followed the roller toward the net, and just like that. His first top shelf as a left-hander on the very last puck. It was amazing. Well, that's where we currently are. Callan has successfully transitioned from a righty to a lefty. He's acquiring new skills each week and is getting more proficient handling and shooting a puck after every rep attempt. Our current challenge is to get a glove to custom fit his hand so he can access the strength needed to take backhand shots and provide the proper protection. Right now he can do it without the glove on, but when he does try it with the glove, it impedes his grip and he loses hold of the stick. If anyone out there would like to get involved in this unique opportunity or could point us in the right direction, please leave your comments below or get in touch with me at onlinehockeytraining.com. Thank you. As I get ready to wrap up this video, I want to leave you with a few things. First, fear is a learned behavior. We aren't born to be fearful. It's something we learn over time. Don't believe me? Just go watch a two-year-old. They're cruising around without a fear in the world. But right behind them is their mom and dad saying, no, 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 no. If there's one thing I can say about Callan is that he has zero fear of trying anything. And how brave is this kid at 7 years old to take on the mission of converting to opposite hand? Kind of brings a tear to your eye, doesn't it? At the beginning of this motivational video, a lot of you were wondering how adversity could be motivational. Well, I hope you now see the angle I was coming from. Cal's hand comes with some challenges, but isn't viewed by him or his family as adversity, only opportunity. It's been said that most people overestimate what they can achieve in 1 year and underestimate what they can achieve in 10 years. I totally underestimated what Cal could and would commit to and what he could achieve in just 1 month. I can't wait to see what this kid is going to be achieving in 10 years. All I know is that it's going to be big. Well, that's a wrap for this video. I'll make sure to give you an update from time to time and let you know how Callan is doing. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.